Hello everyone, good morning. I'm out taking a walk. Very nice day today. It's overcast. Let me show you. This is the trail that I walk on and bike on quite a bit. Over to my right there's a river down there, the Rappahannock River. It's beautiful out here. But today I'm going to do a video, and what prompted this video was a video that I saw very early this morning. I think it was uploaded to the YouTube a few days ago, but it's a sermon that a very popular pastor, I don't believe there are true pastors today, but the name of the video was entitled Pastor GJ. I won't mention his name. I think a lot of you know who I'm talking about. You can work it out. Warning to sinners that they're gonna go to that place, that place of eternal hellfire and torment, because they're sinners. Now, for those of you who watch my videos, I always ask those questions where, okay, who determines who a sinner is and who is not a sinner? Me? You? That pastor? Or the pastors? Or ministers? Or whatever they want to call themselves? I'm saying that in a polite way. But who determines that? I know that all of us are sinners. That all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But this pastor was really hurling hellfire and brimstone, and the guy appears to be reasonably intelligent. And sometimes, you know, I'll scratch my head those kinds of persons, because I wonder, you know, they read the Bible, and it's just not a surface reading. They actually study it. And they don't see this, that we're all sinners. Because a person becomes a Christian, something Jesus never told us to be called anyway, but for the sake of this discussion, that a person becomes a Christian and they accept Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior, that doesn't mean that we automatically don't sin, and that we stop sinning. We're gonna do that. Why? Because we are flawed and imperfect human beings. We can't help it. It's in our nature. It's in our DNA to make mistakes and to mess up and to sin. Now, that's this pastor, he separates himself and those in his audience, congregation, that if they're sinners, rather if they're not sinners, and that if they are Christians, hey, they're okay. You ain't got nothing to worry about. You're not going to that place. You're not going to that eternal place of eternal hellfire and torment. Something Jesus never taught, and something certainly his father never taught or spoke about either. Just read Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 31. Now, I'm going to break up a scripture here, because I don't agree with anything that he said with regards to those who are sinners go to that place. Now, the Apostle Paul tells us something there at Romans chapter 6, verse 23.
Keep your minis and stuff inside the vault.
He says that the wages of sin pays death. One could rephrase that, and some Bible translations do say it this way. The wages sin pays is death. So what does that mean? That means that our deaths are full payment for any sins that we commit in this lifetime. Think about that. Look at that scripture at Romans chapter 6, verse 23 very carefully. The wages sin pays is death. Why is that? Well, thanks to Christ's sacrificial death for all, not just for those who claim or say that they are his followers, but for all of mankind. You see, at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3, we see a hierarchy there. And we're told that above the man is Christ, and above Christ is God. Or it actually says the head of man is Christ, and the head of Christ is God. So our head, that is mankind's head, is Christ. It doesn't say that the head of Christians is Christ. It says the head of man, that is mankind, is Christ. So he died for all of us. So that's something we must always keep in front of us and put all this in perspective, that there is no difference between a person who is what others call a sinner or an unbeliever and one who is not a sinner and one who is a believer. Because who decides and who dictates and determines who those persons are, that they are those things? You see, we're all imperfect. So how can an imperfect person label another imperfect person as being a sinner or an unbeliever? How is that possible? It's not. Jesus gave a parable there in Matthew. I have to look over my shoulder because there are bikes on this trail and sometimes they're not paying attention. But Jesus taught that something about judging others and criticizing others unfairly. He said, first, remove the beam from your own eye so you can see clearly to remove the splinter in your own. You see, a beam is much bigger, much, much bigger than a splinter. So what does that teach us here? That we have no business labeling others this and that because they don't align themselves with what we believe. It's hypocritical. In fact, Jesus does say there, he says, you hypocrites, how can you judge someone when you have this big old beam in your own eye? So apparently this pastor believes that he's removed this beam from his eye so that he can see clearly to label others this and others that. And I see a lot of this within the Christian community. It's not just him. This is a very widespread practice among those who somehow they say, they pay lip service, that, yep, I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. What does that mean? Jesus never said that. See, this is made up stuff. But see, when they do that, they say those kinds of things, it's almost as if what they're doing is they're separating themselves from everyone else. From everyone else. It's this us versus them mentality. And Jesus never taught that either. Now, I want to bring up something that King Solomon said at Ecclesiastes chapter 9, beginning at verse 5, with regards to the living and the dead. He makes a contrast. He says, as for the living, they know that they will die. And that is very true. As I'm speaking to you and as you are listening to me, we are living, right? We know that one day we're going to die. We are conscious of that fact. Then he contrasts the living with the dead. He says, but as for the dead, they do not know anything, or they know nothing at all. So if, as that pastor said, and many believe as he believes as well, that when you die and you are a sinner, you go into that place of eternal hellfire and torment, then how can you be aware, conscious of heat, pain, torture, the passage of time? Now, they all claim they believe the book, that is the Bible, right? But right there at Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5, we're told that the dead, they don't know anything. They're dead. If a person died, say 10,000 years ago, and then let's say he's resurrected today. Years passed over that man. But when he opens his eyes again for the second time, it will be as if he blinked, because when he's in a death state, he's not aware of the passage of time. He's not aware of what's been going on up here among the living. He doesn't know anything, nothing. So that shoots large holes in this idea or notion or belief that if a person is a sinner, they're punished for all eternity in a hellfire. That makes absolutely no sense. And something else one should consider too, it's about justice. Now, for those of you who do know the one true God, you know that he is a just God. Is there anything just about throwing a person into a place of eternal torment for all eternity for, say, 40, 50, 60? Now, another scripture that I want to bring up is Revelation chapter 20, verse 14. And there the Apostle John writes under angelic direction, and it says there that and death and hell, some other translations will say, and death and Hades, that's hell, are thrown into the lake of fire, which is the second death. Now, let's look at that. Bookmark Revelation chapter 20, verse 14, and then go over to the next chapter and let your eyes fall upon Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. There we read, and death will be no more, or there will be no more death. Why? Why is that? Because we just previously read a few verses previous that death and hell are thrown into the lake of fire. So if death will one day be no more because it is thrown into the lake of fire, well, Revelation chapter 20 verse 14 says hell is also thrown there as well. So logically, then hell will one day be no more, just like death. Now, notice there that at Revelation chapter 20, verse 14, that death and hell are mentioned together. So if people will no longer die because death will be no more, then will we have a need for graves? No. People will no longer die one day. So there won't be any need for graves, cemeteries. So that tells us right there what hell is, or Hades is. It is the grave. When I was in Greece quite a few years ago, I taught electronics over there. The Greeks have an expression called helling potatoes. In other words, covering potatoes over with dirt. So what happens to us in general when we die? Well, we're buried. We're covered over with dirt, with earth. It seems like tradition has really kicked in and has taken a tight grip on the minds of many, because the majority of persons that I know who are within this camp called Christianity believes in an eternal hellfire. But yet we can see that hell itself is thrown into the lake of fire. So that means that it itself is not eternal. It will one day be no more or cease to exist. This is a very difficult concept to get the masses to accept and to understand why they don't accept it, because Christianity has been very aggressive in pushing this false narrative. It's almost they bully this false narrative and impose it upon those who join her. And if you don't believe that, then you're, air quote, not a Christian. And they love to use that expression, that if you don't believe certain teachings that issue forth out of Christianity, then you're not a Christian. Something Jesus never told any of us to be called. Now, since death and hell, both together, are thrown into the lake of fire, what does that make the lake of fire, which is the second death? Well, Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 tells us, if death will be no more, because it's thrown into the lake of fire, which is the second death, that means then that the lake of fire is the state of being no more. It is a symbol of non-existence. It is a symbol of being no more. I've heard people say and teach that, well, hell and the lake of fire are the same thing. No, they're not. No, they're not. You can't literally burn death, and you cannot literally burn hell. But both of them are thrown into the lake of fire, which is the second death. Now, Jesus promised something at John chapter 5, verses 28 and 29. He said, do not be amazed at this, for all in their graves, all, not some, all in their graves will hear his voice and come out. The good and the bad, the just and the unjust, the righteous and the unrighteous. See, and God determines who those persons are, right? So, those who are, air quote, sinners, that's all of us, go to that place. We all have that in common. That's our common denominator. We all die, and we all go to the grave. And it's in the grave that we'll remain until we're called out of it, until we're resurrected. That's what's taught, not all this fantasy stuff. Stuff that just doesn't make any sense, and it does not align itself with the things that Christ taught. Eternal hellfire? What kind of person would do that? If a person's already dead, why would God resurrect them from the dead again just to throw them into some place of eternal torment? That makes no sense. The person's already dead. Now, on the day that Jesus died, there was a wicked man, a criminal, an evildoer, who died next to him on the day that he died. Now, you read this at Luke chapter 23, beginning at verse 41. And he asked Jesus to remember him when he comes into his kingdom. And Jesus promised this evildoer, this non-believer, that he would be with him one day in his paradise. So as that pastor was saying or teaching his congregation, well, he's saying that sinners are going to go to hell. Well, what about that man that Jesus promised would be with him in paradise? That man wasn't a follower of Christ. He didn't get baptized. Did he climb down off of his torch stake, off of his staru, and someone dipped him in the water? Mm-mm. He never sat at Christ's feet to be taught by him. So you see, there are things that just don't line up. And those, and there are many of them, who teach this narrative that if you don't accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're a sinner. And that's where you're going. You're going to that place of eternal torment. They cannot reconcile that with the things that I've just spoken here. In fact, they will avoid these things. They won't allow their minds to go there. And if they do, they're very dismissive, and they'll use many words to try to cloak over what the issue here is that the burden's on you. When I say you, these are persons who teach this false narrative of eternal torment. They cannot reconcile those things. So it's much easier for them to take the path of least resistance and don't go there, you see. So that's what I have for you this morning. I'll come at you guys with another video, probably tomorrow, on another thought-provoking topic. You guys take care.